It turns out that we actually oversimplified the problem for you a little bit, and it turns out that this assumption that we made, where all RNA molecules from a given gene should look identical, is not entirely true. So originally, scientists believed that a gene was just a contiguous stretch of DNA, and that this stretch of DNA was transcribed and translated entirely. But in 1977, Sharp and Roberts experimented with messenger RNA, the type of RNA that is translated to protein, of hexon, a specific viral protein. And basically, they took the DNA of this virus, of that specific gene, and they took the mRNA of the same gene, and they hybridized them. So they saw what parts line up perfectly. And it turns out that you got these strange loop structures of DNA that didn't hybridize to the RNA. And this is very strange, and it basically implies that these loops are not showing up in the RNA. So these loops represent introns, we call them, and the contiguous portions that did align are called exons. So exons are the parts of the gene that are actually expressed in a given RNA molecule, whereas introns are parts that, for some reason, mysteriously disappear. So we should actually update our central dogma. We have DNA. DNA is transcribed to what we actually call pre-mRNA. It's not directly transcribed to mRNA. And this pre-mRNA that's transcribed basically has exons, but also has spaces between them called introns that showed up in the DNA, but don't show up in the final protein. So these exons that we have, that we want to express, basically we have to connect them together by cutting out the introns through a process called splicing. And for the most part, all eukaryotic cells do this splicing. And for the most part, no non-eukaryotic cells do this. So it's pretty interesting. And now that we've spliced out the introns, we have the contiguous mRNA that we then translate like normal. So we've just added one additional step where we transcribe into pre-mRNA, and then we have to splice it to get the actual mRNA. So to complicate things a little bit further, there's a phenomenon known as alternative splicing. So given a gene, there's not a one-to-one mapping between the gene and the types of RNA it can produce. So specifically, these exons, in the previous example, we had exon 1, 2, 3 show up. But with alternative splicing, you can have different exons of the same gene show up in different mRNA molecules. So you can basically pick and choose which exons you express in this given RNA molecule. And alternative splicing is the mechanism behind this, where it just cuts out different portions of the pre-mRNA. So as a result, these different isoforms, we call them, these different versions of a given RNA molecule, could have different functions. And as a result, it doesn't suffice to only look at the gene expression. We also have to look at the isoform expression. So even if a given gene is not significantly differentially expressed across two samples, different isoforms of that gene may be, and that might be enough to make a biological impact. So the problem ends up being effectively the same. If we can detect these isoforms, then we can basically count the number of instances of each isoform, normalize the same way that we did before to get FPKM, and then perform the same statistical tests to get a log twofold change as well as a p-value to dictate, is this isoform significantly differentially expressed or not?